Hello everyone, and welcome again to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Sava, and today we're continuing our discussion of value at risk and some potential improvements that can be made over the original value at risk framework to address some of its limitations and to reconcile some of its most controversial assumptions. As we have already discussed, one of the major shortcomings of the variance-covariance approach for calculating value at risk is the normality assumption, or more broadly, distributional assumption regarding the returns of your portfolio that you care about when constructing your variance risk your value at risk measures. Well, here, most commonly we have assumed the normal distribution, and judging by a set of recent videos, you can already figure out that, well, stock returns are not really normally distributed. So to account for this fact, there has been a technique developed to address the non-normality issue, and that is called modified value at risk, or MVaR, that has been developed by Favre and Galliano in 2002. This measure is not perfect by any means. It only accounts for skewness and kurtosis of the original return distribution. So what it accounts for is it accounts for third and fourth moment of the empirical stock return distribution and allows you to calculate value at risk for some arbitrary distributions that are non-normal. What is the logic? Well, sometimes the return distributions might be skewed to the right or to the left and have positive kurtosis, so have fat or heavy tails, so higher probability of extreme events to occur. And the value at risk measure, at least an adequate value at risk measure, should either penalize or reward for those deviations from normality. So the logic is that, first of all, an adequate value at risk measure should penalize for high positive kurtosis, because the heavier the tails are, the more likely it is that an extreme negative event will occur, triggering an extreme loss. So value at risk should be higher in terms of magnitude of the loss for distributions with higher positive kurtosis. And also, it should account for skewness. It should reward positive skewness, right skewness. So if you are more likely to arrive at positive observations, then your value at risk should be lower in terms of absolute magnitude. And it should penalize for negative skewness if your portfolio return distribution is skewed to the left. So it's more likely that you will arrive at a loss. Well, then value at risk should penalize it for you by generating a higher loss for respective confidence interval, all other things held equal. Favre and Galliano had accommodated for all of those stylized facts in their formula by generating this sophisticated function that will generate you modified value at risk for respective value of a confidence interval. You see, they still have z-stats over here, that z-stats being standard inverse normal distributions of the respective confidence interval, but they adjust it for skewness, kurtosis, and skewness squared. And that allows you to adjust your z-stat so that you have a more realistic account for skewness and kurtosis and respective rewards and penalties an adequate value at risk measure should provide you with. So without further ado, let's apply both the conventional VCV VAR as well as the modified VAR for our S&P 500 returns over the last 5 years. Well, we obviously need the sample mean, so average over the whole area of returns, and the sample standard deviation, STDEV.S, of the same area of returns. And for modified VAR, we also need the skewness, so skew of the historical returns, and the sample kurtosis, kurt. So we can see that we have a textbook case of a return distribution where modified VAR might be helpful. We have negative skewness and positive kurtosis, something that modified value at risk should penalize us for. And that's something that is unaccounted for in the standard variance-covariance value at risk. So let's compare the two. For the standard value at risk, we'll just need to get the sample mean and log it, add the standard deviation and log it as well, and multiply it by the standard normal inverse distribution corresponding to a particular confidence interval. And we can drag it down and have various outputs of our VCV value at risk function. Now let's apply this function developed by Favre and Galliano to account for skewness and kurtosis. So we start as usual, mean, and we lock the cell, plus standard deviation. But now our z-stat will be adjusted for skewness and kurtosis. So we multiply it, open the bracket, and start just as usual, standard normal inverse distribution of the confidence interval, plus now we penalize for negative skewness or reward for positive skewness. We add 1/6 times our original z-stat squared, so norm s inv of that squared minus 1 times the sample skewness, and we need to lock that as we will drag it down for various confidence intervals. So we have accounted for positive or negative skewness. Now we add 1/24 times our original z-stat cubed minus 3 original z-stats. Then we need to multiply it by our sample kurtosis. That will reward us for negative kurtosis and penalize us for positive kurtosis, extreme fat or heavy tails. And then we need to account for skewness squared. So we add 1/36 times 2 times our original z-stat cubed minus 5 of our original z-stat. And then we multiply this bracket by skewness, and we lock the skewness squared. And then we close the bracket and we can enforce this bulky yet really handy formula. And we see that the modified value at risk, even at 5% confidence interval, is higher in absolute terms than the regular VCV value at risk. But as we bottom right click it all the way down, we can see how the difference accumulates over the time as we move from high confidence intervals to low confidence intervals. If you want to account for a very extreme events, 0.1% cases, 1 in 1,000 days to be precise, then the difference between the regular value at risk that assumes normality and modified value at risk that accounts for arbitrary skewness and kurtosis is very, very prominent. And now we can do some comparative statics and see whether our modified value at risk formula correctly accounts for all the stylized facts, that it does indeed reward for positive skewness, penalize for negative skewness, and penalize for extreme positive kurtosis. First of all, if our skewness and kurtosis were zero, so our distribution would be normal, then value at risk and modified value at risk are exactly the same. So if we have skewness being positive, so for example, our skewness would be 0.5, then we'll see that our modified value at risk is lower in absolute terms than the value at risk, reflecting the fact that positive skewness, so high probability of positive returns, lower probability of losses, is indeed rewarded. If we have negative skewness, so minus 0.5, we have increasing losses predicted by modified VAR. And if we increase kurtosis, the higher we increase the kurtosis, the higher is the predicted loss at very low confidence intervals. But you might notice that if we go, for example, to kurtosis of 10, which is very high, we have very high losses at low confidence intervals, but smaller losses at high confidence intervals. That corresponds to the fact that heavier tails basically reflect the fact that at the peak of the distribution becomes thinner. So the losses at higher confidence intervals might decrease, while the losses at the very tail of the distribution will explode. And that's all there is for modified VAR and accounting for arbitrary skewness and kurtosis in valid risk calculations. Please leave a like under this video if you found it helpful. Leave any suggestions for further topics in business economics and finance you might want me to investigate in the comments below. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Thank you very much and stay tuned.